Good morning. Well, thank you for the invitation to be here this morning. It's a pleasure to be here to talk with you today about inclusive entrepreneurship. Now, what I want to do today is just to tell you a little bit about the work that we have done at the OECD. We are undertaking a work program in partnership with the European Commission on inclusive entrepreneurship policies. And so I want to give you a little bit of context, and then we'll talk about some of the policy instruments that are used in the EU. And I will give you a few quick examples just to make the discussion more concrete. And then I believe we have time for a few questions. So let's get into it. So I work at the OECD. For those of you that don't know, the OECD is an international intergovernmental organization. We have 34 member countries on all continents. And our purpose is to facilitate policy dialogue between the countries. So countries will come together through projects or meetings or conferences to talk about policy challenges, and they will discuss what each has done to try to address the challenge. And so we share experiences and we try to learn from each other. So we're based in Paris. We have nearly 3,000 employees, and we work in all policy areas, with one exception, which is military. So today we're here to talk about inclusive entrepreneurship, and I wanted to start just by letting you know what I mean more precisely about that term. So what I mean is that we're talking about entrepreneurship that contributes to social inclusion and allows all people to have an opportunity to start a business. Now, this means supporting groups such as young people, women, seniors, ethnic minorities, migrants, people with disabilities, trying to provide an opportunity for all of these groups to start a business. So the goal of policy action in this area is to try to increase the number of business startups, but also increase the quality of the business startups so that we have more high quality businesses that can sustain over time. But an important thing to remember is that through these policy actions, people gain skills and they gain experience. So not everybody will be successful in business creation, but they might have learned something or gained experience that will help them in another activity, such as employment, for example. And so an important element of these policies is to try to help increase the employability of an individual. So a good place to start our discussion today is just to get a bit of an idea about what we are talking about in terms of numbers, to try to wrap around our head about the size of the issue. And so this is a figure. It's called new business ownership rates. And so this shows the proportion of adults in each country that owns a new business. And so we can see that it ranges from about 2 to 5% across these countries in the EU. And so the bar, the blue bar, that's the overall average for all adults. And then I added some diamonds to show you the different rates for the different groups. And so we can see that women, which are the dark blue diamond, are below the overall average. You can see the older people, the red diamond, are also below the average. And the youth, which is the yellow diamond, is a bit of a mixed picture. In some countries, they are below or approximately equal to the average, while in other countries, they are greater than the average. But I just want to remind you about a point that I made earlier, in that the goal of inclusive entrepreneurship policy is to not only increase the number, but also the quality. And we know that quality is an issue for youth entrepreneurship, in that many youth have quite low survival rates for their businesses. They don't last very long. And so when we're thinking about supporting youth, quality is probably the thing that we are most concerned about. Anyway, so if we're talking about inclusive entrepreneurship, trying to support all these groups, we could expect to have a quite significant impact. If we were to make all of these groups equal to the average, we would have about 20 million additional businesses in the EU. Now, I mention that just to give you an idea. That number makes me slightly nervous because it's probably too high. I don't think we can expect all of these groups to be average, but I mention it just to give you an idea about the scale of impact that we can have in this area. So, why do these groups have barriers? What is stopping them from being self-employed or starting a business? There are various data sources that we can look at that try to ask questions about that issue. One is the Eurobarometer, and so I've put some data here. And we can see that the most often cited challenge is that people do not have enough money, capital. They also mention frequently the business environment, skills, no idea, difficulty managing self-employment with other family commitments. And then there are some issues with attitudes towards failure and administrative difficulties. Again, I put the diamonds onto the overall average to show you that there is quite a variation between different groups. So if we look at the yellow diamond, which is youth, they clearly face the most difficulties with accessing finance and skills. Women, the dark blue diamond, they're not that different than the average. They're more likely to indicate that they have difficulty accessing capital, and also more likely to indicate issues balancing family life. Older people, not surprisingly, have probably had a long career already, and so they have experience. They might have some savings more than young people, and so they're actually less likely to face barriers in a lot of these areas. So please keep this in mind as we go through the day, because when we're talking about policy actions, policy should always try to address a barrier. So, in the EU, most policy actions tend to focus in these four areas. Access to finance, trying to help people access capital to start their business, or training, trying to help people gain the skills to run a business, and often experience as well. And when I talk about entrepreneurship skills, I'm using it in a fairly broad sense. So there are some technical skills that are required when you start and operate a business. You need to know how to register a business. You need to know what you have to do when you want to hire an employee. But there are other skills that entrepreneurs need as well. Team building, you need to know how to work with people. You need to know how to identify opportunities and how to take advantage of these opportunities. Risk management is another important one. So the point is that there are a whole suite of skills that entrepreneurs need, and often training provides these, but many of these skills are applicable across all of the aspects of an individual's life, whether it's in self-employment, or working as an employee, or in their family and personal life, or volunteer work. Coaching and mentoring is another popular approach. It's a bit more intensive than training, but again, the idea is to increase the skill level of an individual. Now, coaching is typically a one-on-one relationship, but it doesn't have to be. We see increasing programs that are group or peer coaching and mentoring, where people help each other. And finally, there are a lot of policy actions in the area of institutions, both formal institutions, such as your business regulatory framework, and informal institutions, your culture, attitude towards risk, attitude towards failure, or entrepreneurs seen as positive in society. And often these institutional approaches are done through the education system or awareness campaigns But there are a number of countries that do have regulatory measures that they use to provide incentives or to make it a little bit easier for entrepreneurs during their initial year or two of business. It could be reduced tax obligations or perhaps relaxed requirements on social security contributions. There's a range of instruments used. Now, what I want to do is just slightly unpack each of these now, and then I'll show you a few concrete examples of how this is done in practice. So for finance, of course, we have a wide range of instruments. We tend to promote repayable instruments over grants. There are various reasons for that. First, it's easier on public finances in that you don't have to bear the full risk of the entrepreneur. But it's also often provides more of an incentive for the entrepreneur. They take their project more seriously if they have to pay back all or a portion of the funds that they have received. So some key success factors in financing programs in the EU for inclusive entrepreneurship are the use of a competitive delivery mechanism. Now, in all EU countries, some more than others, resources are quite limited. And so one of the key challenges with policy work in this area is trying to decide who should get the support or who should get the most intense support. In finance, who should get the money or more money? And the most successful programs tend to use a funnel system to provide perhaps a little bit of funding to a lot of people, and then those who have demonstrated success are eligible for more funding or a larger loan. Or oftentimes business competitions are used, and then a range of prizes is awarded to those with the best ideas. It's also important to remember that financing itself is not enough. We need to couple financing with other support to help ensure that the participant knows how to use that money and they can use it effectively. So a lot of times, training is paired with financing or coaching as well. Now, training, as I mentioned, is another of the most popular approaches. It's important that training teaches about business startup, but also about how to sustain and manage a business and grow it over time. And that's one of the weaknesses in most training programs, is that they help a person start, but then after the business has launched, the person is left to fend for themselves, and they aren't necessarily equipped with the skills to manage their business. A key challenge that is also important for training programs is reaching potential clients and ensuring that the potential clients know that the training is available. So outreach is important, and the most successful training programs in the EU tend to partner with specialized organizations. It could be a youth organization or a key migrant organization that's based in the migrant community to try to increase awareness about the training offer. And the quality of training is often improved by using actual entrepreneurs themselves, someone with experience running a business. But it is also important to give the trainers a little bit of training, because being a successful entrepreneur does not necessarily mean you will be a good trainer or a good coach, for example, because you might not have good training skills or communication skills. So for coaching and mentoring, the approaches used in the EU tend to be more towards the mentoring element rather than coaching. And I differentiate them in the sense that mentoring is a bit more broad. It tends to cover both business development as well as personal development. And coaching, I would define as being slightly more targeted to a specific challenge or issue. Coaching relationships tend to be a bit shorter and much more focused on a specific problem. But regardless of the approach used, it's important to have coaches and mentors that are accessible to the clients, to the entrepreneurs, and someone that the entrepreneur can identify with. And so oftentimes the matching of the coach or the mentor to the entrepreneur is the most critical element of a coaching and mentoring program. It's important to have a relationship built on trust, and that is most easily done by having a mentor that has a similar background as the entrepreneur. We also encourage limits to the relationship. Have it set for 1 year or 2 years, not an undefined period, because that risks developing a relationship based on dependence. And the idea is that we want to help the entrepreneur become independent, help them integrate into society and be able to function on their own. So for institutions, as I mentioned, there are a wide range of approaches used to address culture and also regulatory challenges or opportunities, depending on how you view it. One of the most popular approaches in the EU is what is called a welfare bridge. And this is targeted for people who are unemployed. And it's a mechanism that allows an unemployed person to continue to collect their benefits while they are in the process of launching and running their business during the first few months. This ensures that they have some income to sustain their ability to live. There are some variations of the approach, but we can see large-scale programs in countries such as Germany, Finland, and they use slightly different approaches, but more or less it's the same mechanism. Of course, we can always reduce the complexity and number of business regulations, but if you think back to the figure that I showed you about barriers, administrative challenges was at the far end. Only 3 or 4% think that it's actually a barrier. And so if we're trying to have an impact with inclusive entrepreneurship policies, this is probably not the tool that will have the biggest impact. So just very briefly, because we will talk about examples later this morning, I just want to give you a bit of a flavor of different approaches used around the EU. And so I picked just a couple of examples that have a very unique element about them. And this first one is a training program in Slovenia for unemployed, highly qualified youth. So these are typically university graduates that can't find a job. And it's run through regional development agencies, and it's entrepreneurship training that's delivered in modules. And then after the module is finished, in theory, the person starts a business, and then they can access business counseling for a year. So this is sort of a standard approach, but the thing that is unique is that the regional development agency hires the students as employees while they are on training. So this is essentially a financial support, but the mechanism used is that they are taken on as an employee. So this program in Lithuania is a financial program. It's a mainstream program. Anybody can access it. But it's an example of how a mainstream program can be tailored and targeted to specific groups. So although anybody can access it, youth, women, older people, and people with disabilities have preferred access to it. And the way the program works is that each applicant who can apply either online or in any credit union is then assigned an officer to help them through the whole process. So the officer helps them complete their application. The officer represents the applicant to the board when they're making the lending decision. And then in between, the applicant can access a wide range of training as well as coaching and mentoring. So this is run by the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry of Social Security in cooperation with the Central Credit Union in Lithuania. And it's quite successful. More than 4,000 people have gone through it. And nearly 2,000 jobs have been created through this program in the last couple of years. So it's doing quite well. It's having a good impact. And it's an example of how a mainstream approach can be used for certain target groups. The last one is sort of a classical example from the UK, and it's the Prince's Trust program for youth entrepreneurs. Now, this is for young entrepreneurs that have been unable to access financing through banks or other financial institutions. And it provides them a small grant to get going, and they can access training. But then there are larger grants and some even innovative loan programs that they can access once they have demonstrated an ability to operate and implement their idea. And although the evaluation evidence is a little bit old now, there is evidence that shows a benefit to cost ratio of 17 to 1. So for every pound or euro invested, it's resulted in 17 euros of benefits. So I'll just end by letting you know that you can get a lot more information than what I've talked about today through our various reports. So these have been all produced in cooperation with the European Commission. This first set is a series of policy briefs. These are short reports, about 25 pages. And they're all available for free on the internet. And each one focuses on a specific issue, ranging from youth entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship, informal economy, and so on. There are 9 of them. And we also have a series of books called The Missing Entrepreneurs. And in these books, you will find a lot of data about activity rates and barriers. And there are also thematic policy chapters that cover different issues. And then finally, at the end, we have a section where there is a note on each EU country with a policy example and data from that country. So the first two books are available. The third book, the 2015, will be available on the 13th of November. And the policy discussion in that one focuses on growth and helping inclusive entrepreneurs grow their businesses, as well as coaching and mentoring, and how to design and implement effective coaching and mentoring for these target groups. So thank you for your attention today. I'm happy to take any questions now, or at any point during the day, you can grab my jacket and I'd be happy to discuss this further with you. So thank you.